Yeah. Recording has started. We can start. Recording has started. We can start.
Okay. Thank you, Bhaiya. Good evening, everyone. Very in VIP program. Today we have the great session with Rahul Prasampuria. He has a very good experience in the Company Act and NCLT. So, yeah. First, I would request to our president, C.A. Vishnu Tulsiyan ji, to give the opening remarks.
Thank you, my dear friend, Gopal, my learned speaker, Rahul, my good friend, Vivek Bhaiya, and all the audience in this Zoom platform. Friends, thank you for inviting me to give an introductory remark for this program. Friends, nowadays we are all looking that the Act is being more stringent and they are more focusing on the compliance part. And then something is wrong, found wrong, then of course there's a fine, penalty or punishment. In the case of anything, transactions found anything which is not true in the spirit, then there may be investigation also. These types of provisions always in the Company Act, Income Tax and other statute of the Parliament. Here we today are holding this GT seminar for the purpose of discussing various inquiry, investigations and part of the Company Act from the point of view of the Company Act. And for this, none other than my younger brother Rahul is here to make us more enlightened on this subject. Being normally the section 206 to 212 and SFIU will be dealt by Rahulji, and of course he will share his personal experiences on the matter of this how to deal with these situations. As a president, I would like to just bring to the notice that we association are roughly having 800 chartered accountants, and we are the only association which has a chartered accountant as a member, none other this profession. We have developed this benefaction policy for the young chartered accountant this year. And we have also the contributory of the CABF fund. Apart from that, for our members, we have the Eklavya Award for their children to encourage them for the further study. We are having the dedicated library at the Bangur for the CSCS course accountant. And we have also made a lot of tie-up with the professional bodies with the help of Zoom when they're on the virtual meeting to make our endeavor more visible to the audiences. With these small remarks, now I hand over the proceedings to the chairman back, Gopalji, to take it ahead. Thanks, welcome, and welcome all of you too again. Thank you.
Thank you, Vishnu Bhaiya, for your such a kind remarks. I take the pleasure to give the brief introduction of C.S. Ram Prasampuria is a fellow member of the Institute of Company Secretary of India, along with a commerce graduate from Calcutta University. Driven by his own interest and passion towards his corporate litigations, he is presently running a firm, Prasampuria and Associate, providing legal advisory service in the field of corporate law and litigations. He has a good experience in the RERA, RBI, DRT, SFIO, SEBI matters. Rahul regularly appears in the matter of NCLT on the Insolvency Company Act matters. He is a regular frequent the speaker on the platform of various platforms, study circles, and the ICI, ICSI, ICMA, on all this. He is a very good and young speaker. I warm welcome Rahul in the VIP platform to you. Please, I hand over the proceeding to you. Rahul, please.
Yes. Thank you, Gopal Bhai, for the crisp introduction, and thank you, respected President Vishnu Bhaiya, for giving me this opportunity. So, and also thank you to all the organizers of VIP Chartered Accountant Study Circle. More specifically, I have already named Gopal Bhai and Rohit Bhai, Rohit Kejriwal Ji, Rahul Lunta Ji is there. So coming on to the topic, today we are on the third phase of our lockdown in the state of West Bengal. So for we are quite confused that whether it is a lockdown or whether it is open and what is happening. So, but still we have found an opportunity to equip ourselves with the knowledge of the Companies Act. So this particular topic which is given to me is basically inspection, investigation and inquiry under the Companies Act. So I must tell you in advance that the time allotted to me is say around 2 hours already. We have 15 minutes have been passed. So that is just a drop in the bucket, because this topic itself is very huge and there is lot of legal precedents. There is lot of sections, there is lot of nitty-gritties, and this particular sections itself enumerates, you have to link it with all the sections of the Companies Act as well. So I'll try to do justice as many as I can do with this particular 2 hours. So how we'll be moving ahead with the topic is like that. First, I'll take you all through my slides and presentation with respect to inquiry, investigation, and your inspection. Then thereafter, in the second half, what we'll do is towards the end, we'll take on the questions from all the members who is present there. And parallelly also, if anybody wants, they can put in their question in the chat box, so we can do it likewise. So is that okay, President sir and Gopal bhai?
It's okay, sir.
Yes, okay. So just let me allow to do screen share.
Yes, sir.
Yes. I was just asking that we'll take the question towards the end, and first I'll
come yes. on with. Yes. Towards the end, it will be much better, I believe.
Yes, yes. So just I need to share the slide. Yes. If you can just confirm me whether the slide is visible.
Yes, it is visible right now. Okay.
So the topic given, as we already know, the III, that is basically inquiry, inspection, and investigation. And with the topic, we have started a peek into. So a peek into means I will quickly delve upon all the sections basically which are concerning the inquiry from the purview of the Companies Act, inspection from the purview of the Companies Act, and more specifically the investigation. So investigation is a broader term basically which includes both the inquiry and inspection. And investigation is basically a phenomena which is to be undertaken by a agency or a report. And on the basis of that, the punishment, penalty, and that has to be awarded. So let us move on. And what are the focus area which I'll be, which we'll be dealing is that. So why inquiry, inspection, or investigation? What is the reason that the inquiry is being called for a company? What is the reason that once the inquiry is not satisfactorily done by the company or the directors of the company, then there is a case of an inspection? And finally, if both the things is not being satisfied well to the department, or they are not satisfied yet, they have made out a prima facie case with respect to the working of the company, which where they want to look into the affairs of the company. So then comes in the role of the investigation. So there are a number of sections which deal with investigations. So the 2000 Companies Act also recognizes SFIO basically, which is a dedicated multidisciplinary, you can say a multidisciplinary organization, which has been given a huge power with respect to dive into the details of the companies and to take out what has been wrong in the company, what has led to made the company such a movement, how the public money has been used. So looking after the affairs of the company, even at times, number of matters, we have seen the corporate veil has also been lifted by the SFIO to look back who is the person who is controlling the affairs of the company, who is the person who are the beneficial owner of the company, and what was the reason and what was the intent, basically the mens rea which has led to the such a situation, such say a white collar crime into the company. Then we'll see what are the detailed legal provisions. So basically the legal provisions here are divided into 4 parts. So first part is section 206, 207, 208. So that first part basically deals with the inspection and inquiry. Thereafter, there is section 212, which deals with SFIO. Then we have section 2110, 213, which deals with 216, which deal with the investigation into the affairs of the company. And then the general provisions are there after 216, that is 217, 218, 19 to 20, to all these particular subheadings. Then we'll see what are the type of non-compliances that will attract inquiry and inspection into the company. And how to handle during the course of the session, we'll also discuss about how to handle and how to what are the recourses available to the company to deal with such of the non-compliances and to reply to the notices which have been received by the ROC. Then what are the fraud and punishment attached for the non-compliance of the inquiry and investigation section? So here there are penalties with respect to non-compliance of the section, non-compliance of the provisions of the company's code. There is also a provision or a penalty which has been attached where you not comply with the provisions of the inquiry, inspection, and investigations as well. So that is also there. Then we'll be discuss about various reports of which ROC or the central government with regards to the investigation of the company, and how, why, and who commit frauds. So that will be dealt in the overall session. So let us see why inquiry takes place. What is the preliminary and what is the fundamental which the ROC takes into or looks into while initiating an inquiry? So let us see some of which I have just noted it down. For the purpose of strengthening the information in registry or to fill the missing gaps in complete filing. So we all know that there are number of forms there. So nowadays MCA is very active with respect to getting an information from the company. So lots of information, there are MTF number of form which has to be filed to the MCA time and again with respect to deposits, with respect to CSR spending, with respect to significant beneficial ownership, with respect to interest, with respect to board meetings, with respect to special resolution. So there are number of things which has to be filed to the MCA time and again. So in that filing, if there is any incompleteness, if there is any gap in which the company or the person concerned who is filing the form has missed out a specific information which is required for the proper corporate governance, for the proper disclosure from the end of the company. So in that situation, if the ROC makes out an opinion, then the inquiry is called for. Then financial statements, documents indicate prima facie non-compliance variances in financial data. So there have been a number of situations where one will find that the auditors also receive notice for the purpose of not complying with the accounting standards. So section 129 speaks about that the financial statement has to comply with the as per section 133 of the Companies Act, all the accounting standards. So even on that instances, various times it has been seen that the auditors as well as the directors, the auditors are marked as a CC to that notices, and they are also asked to provide an information. So financial statements document prima facie indicating non-compliance of various debts and financial data. Then the audit qualifications, if there has been any qualification given by the auditor in the audit report. So the ROC may look into that audit report and may further like to get more information from the company. So that is the case. Then we have when there are doubt on existence of the company. So there are number of situations, there are number of times where there is a reason to believe that what is the purpose for which the company was being formed, whether it is just a sham company, whether it is a company only for the purpose of accommodation. So that particular thing, if there is any clue which the ROC finds and he wants to inquire about the workings of the company, so the notices has been sent for the purposes of inquiry. Then to redress the grievances raised by the investors, depositors, and other stakeholders. So this is one of the common cause for sending an inquiry notice. There are a number of grievances which are oftenly raised by the investors or the depositor. This mainly happens with the public company. So I must tell you in starting that this sections of inquiry, investigations, and everything has no exception. It is applicable on all the companies, whether it is a private company, whether it is a public company, whether it is an unlisted public company, whether it is an NBFC and whatsoever. So it is applicable on all the companies. So coming to the point, redress grievance raised by investor, depositor, and other stakeholders. So there are a number of situations where the investors are not satisfied, where the depositors are not satisfied. Right now we are seeing in NCLT, there are a number of matters with respect to where the depositor and the debenture holders have filed with respect to non-redemption of their debentures and that situation. So often the inquiry and investigation orders have also been passed by the NCLT as well. So that particular grievances, if not redressed, that may culminate into an inquiry. Then reference from other regulators and departments. So there may be an instances where other regulators like the SEBI, like Competition Commission, like your say any other ED, CBI or whatever may be. So they may often give a reference to the ROC to probe into the affairs of the company, to dig into the information which is required for to get hold of the working of the company. Then verify facts on the basis of the investor complaints or otherwise. It is almost similar to that of that if there is any complaint from any investor regarding any of the non-compliance or regarding any of the promise which has been done or regarding any aspects. So that verification also for the just not for the purpose of launching a prosecution or not for the purpose of giving a show cause notice, the ROC may simply inquire as well. So this is not a so-called notice, but one must not confuse it with it is just an inquiry. It may land up to a so-called notice, it may land up to an investigation or inspection, but initially it is just an inquiry by the Registrar of Companies. We'll in detail see section 206, what is the wording of the statute with respect to that. Then financial statements indicate too good or too bad financial position, exceptional, irrational changes in the financial results or state of affairs. So if there has been a substantial change in the financial statements from that of the previous years, or say from that of the holding company or the subsidiary company, or there has been an impact. So this is also a situation where the inquiry is called for by the Registrar of Companies suo motu. Then verify the utilization of IPO, FPO proceeds as per the stated object. So now there is a case of MSME listings and such kind of listings are there happening. So number of IPOs, FPOs and offers are coming on. So to get whether the source of the fund has been utilized properly, the utilization of the funds and everything has been done as stated. So that may often, for that also the ROC conducts the inquiry. Then why inspection? So you will find it similarity, but once we'll go through the session, so you will be able to make out that there is a difference in inquiry and inspection. Thin line of difference maybe, but there is a difference in inquiry and inspection. So refusal, disobedience of the scrutiny inquiry order. So as I told you, the first step is inquiry. So if you are refusing to reply to the Registrar of Companies, if you are disobedient to the notices which have been received by the company, you are not replying to the notices which has been received by you, so that may land up to the inspection. So that is what refusal, disobedience of the scrutiny inquiry orders. Then inquiry indicates need for deeper examination of the books of accounts, say for volume of records. So inquiry indicates need for deeper. So what ROC has done, ROC has sent a notice under section 206 for a preliminary inquiry. On the reply received by the company or the director whatsoever, maybe the capacity of the director, if on that determination the ROC forms that no, the further detailed examination is also required, ROC is not satisfied with the reply given by the company. So on that situation, what happens? That inquiry is converted into inspection and the company is called for the books of accounts and the volume of records and statutory registers and whatsoever to get an inspection of the financial statement and other books of accounts. Then need to verify the disclosure in the financial statements with the books of accounts and the records. So this is related to the financial part. So whether the balance sheet or the financial position is the window dressed or certain situation, in that kind of position, a verification is required from the part of the ROC in the financial statement with that of the book. So oftenly in number of companies it is found that now we are seeing in number of matters which are pending before IBC in CIRP. So you'll find that there are 2-3 sets of books, even the set of books are not available as well in the company. So that is a huge problem for the resolution professional to get the set of books available. So there is a 19-2 applications coming up. So this is the reason that where if there is any inconsistency or any mismatch in the disclosure or anything which ROC can smell or getting an information or a complaint from an investor. So for that regarding, in order to verify it, whether the balance sheet is matching with the books of accounts, the inspection can be done. Then collection of evidence, of course. So say the matter is pending before any court where the court has ordered the ROC to for doing an inspection or investigation. In that situation, this records will act as a evidence. Then recording of statements. So the statements are also recorded from the from the directors and the officers in charge regarding the conduct of the business, and that may again be produced in the court of law. Then physical verification of the register or other officers of the company. So that is also a situation. The number of section 12 notices are also there with respect to non-maintenance of the registered office. And higher number or frequency of investor complaints. So if any particular company which is not addressing the complaints or the queries of the investors, and the investors is finding no way. So this is the habit of that particular company, and there is a lot of complaints which is coming on to the PG portal or either say a ROC or to RD or whatever may be. So in that situation also, that may lead up to an inspection against that particular company. Then why investigation? So normally the similar reasons, but where large interest and the number of investor or stakeholders are invested. So as I told you, investigation is a broad heading. So often you will find that the source of initiating an investigation is same. What we have discussed in our previous two slides with respect to your inquiry and inquiry and inspection. But this is comparatively a macro aspect where there is a large interest of the public is involved, large number of investors are involved, the stakeholders are low. So here in our country, we have number of private companies, we have a partnership which is converted, a quasi-partnership type of a company. So in that situation, oftenly we have seen that there is either some way out has been taken by the court or the even the government also, departments also not like to put in their resources into that company and leaving behind the big shots. So that is why the investigations is basically for that particular white collar crimes, if I may call, for regarding the deeper analysis of that particular transactions and that particular companies. Huge public money is involved, say a fraud with the bank, an intention to deceive the creditors. And these are the situations where the investigations like the Mehul Choksi matter is the number one example of this particular, ILFS is an example of that particular thing. So these are particular situations where the investigations will be called for. Then inquiry inspection indicates element of fraud. As I told you that fraud, as soon as we hear the word fraud, the criminality comes into the place. So till then we may call it either a civil dispute or say a matter of a corporate issue or a non-compliance or whatever may be. But with fraud, the intention comes into place, the mens rea, that the intention to conduct a business was not was to deceive the creditors, was to cause harm to the public, was to siphon of the money of the public or the company. So that particular element of the fraud, if has been found out during the stage of inquiry and inspection by the ROC or the inspecting officer, so that may then be landed up to further investigation into the affairs of the company. Then specific issues are to be examined instead of general examination of books of accounts and records. So there is a specific issue. There may be number of issues. There may be number of issues in a company that the company has not done the disclosure of this, the company has not done this, the company has not done that, the company has not shown a proper disclosure and everything. But the major issue is like the company has siphoned off the funds, the company has taken the loan from the bank and there is no position to repay back the money, the company has taken intercorporate loan. So the company has siphoned off the money basically from that particular thing. So this particular investigation will be targeted to that particular aspect. So it may be one or it may be many. So there may be number of, so more specifically the investigation or that particular happens with respect to your where the public money is involved, more specifically where the lot huge amount of money is involved and which may cause a pinch to a nation. So in that situations the investigations are ordered. So now this was a cursory glance that where an inquiry, where an investigation and where your inspection can be ordered or can be initiated on these particular circumstances. Now, what are the legal provisions behind this? So the legal provision behind this, first and foremost, the Chapter 14 of the Companies Act is a self-contained code. So this is the code which is a self-contained, and one may have to refer this particular sections with respect to inquiry, inspection and your investigation. So Chapter 14 of Companies Act. There we have Section 206 to 209, as I already told you. Then the investigation part is in Section 2110, 229. Then we also have Section 90, which speaks about the SBO, that is the beneficial ownership. There is also a provision with respect to the investigation into the affairs of the company. Then 457 situations where the information may be called for. Then we all know 447, 448 and 449 with respect to fine and penalty. So now it will be just a quick glance through the 447 with respect to the penalty provision in case of fraud, basically just a quick through with respect to this position that act of omission, concealment of fact, abuse of position by any person or any other person with connivance, with an intent to deceive or cause gain undue advantage from injure interest from a company, shareholder, creditor, whether or not wrongful or not. So the basically fraud we have already discussed in brief there. So the to gain an undue advantage or to injure the interest of the company, shareholder, creditor, or the any of the stakeholder which is attached to the company, whether or not is a wrongful gain or loss, so that may amount to your stringent punishment under section 447. And what is the conviction involved there? Imprisonment minimum 6 months and maximum up to 10 years, and fine which may go up to 3 times the amount involved, and imprisonment which shall not be less than 3 years if the fraud involved. So just I have shown you the 447. We already know that this is one of the most talked about penalty section in the Companies Act. So straight away we are coming into section 206, that power to call for information and inspect books and conduct of the inquiries. There are, I guess, some questions are coming in the chat. So am I audible? Can anybody confirm me? Because I can see nobody and it's like a monologue from my end. If anybody can just confirm whether everything sound and all is okay. Anybody from the organizers? Okay. Yes. Okay, I have received it. So coming to section 206, basically section 206 is a power to call for information, inspect books and conduct of inquiry. So this is a particular section which deals about the inquiry. Only this is the only section, I must say, which deals about the purposes of inquiry. So I must tell you at the start that basically the inquiry is with respect to the overall aspect of the company. This is just a preliminary inquiry that where the ROC in the form of a written letter, in the form of a written notice is asking for an information, any miss out information or any information if not supplied in complete on the examination of the forms or scrutiny of the documents. Then inspection is specifically with respect to your books of accounts or the records which is maintained by the company. And then investigation is with respect to the affairs of the company, that is the business of the company, how the business of the company is running. So that is the thing. So coming on to this section, as I told you at the start, that it is applicable to all the companies, including the government companies. So no companies are escaped out of this. So the trigger point here is that opinion of the registrar before sending a letter for inquiry, the registrar has to form an opinion. So how the opinion will be formed, what will be the basis of an opinion? So there will, these are the 2 points which will form an opinion, basis for opinion. First, on the scrutiny of any document filed by the company. So we are filing number of forms on a day-to-day basis. So there has to be an proper check with respect to that particular form, that there are number of times professionals are coming to ROC with respect to cancellation of SRN, with respect to cancellation of that particular things, that there has been a mistake in the form. So we have to be very, very sound while filing the forms before the ROC, that all the provisions have been compliant, what are the required field and everything. So it may so happen that if the form has been on a, because even the STP forms are subject to your scrutiny. So there's on a say a permutation combination basis. So there are number of form, even the STP forms are scrutinized. So it may so happen that there may be not a willing mistake, but there has been some clerical error or maybe any kind of error which may often lead to your client to get an notice under section 206. So while filing a form to an ROC, we must analyze all the information which is required, and thereafter we'll have to progress the filing of the form. So there has to be a check twice, thrice or whatever maybe, so that no information is missed out or no incorrect information is provided in the form. Then on any information received by him. So any information we have seen that number of complaints are oftenly filed to the ROC, either by the investor, either by the depositor, either by any of the stakeholders or whatever creditors may be. So on these two bases, so basically these are the underlying instances where the ROC may form an opinion, and on the basis of that opinion, the registrar can call by a written notice to furnish in writing such information or explanation and to produce such documents. So as I told you, the mode of communication will be written both from the registrar and from the company. So the mode of communication both will be written to furnish in writing such information or explanation to produce such document within the time and to the extent specified in the notice. So the notice itself speaks about the time and the extent, the manner in which the information has to be provided. So there are a number of sections with respect to which the notices are received, like non-compliance of, if there is any non-compliance with respect to section 185, section 186, section 128, 129, accounting standard 14, accounting standard 18, 188.5. So number of sections while looking onto that particular aspects, if the ROC may find out some nitty-gritties, so they may call for an information. Yes, so the duty of the, now after receiving a notice, so subsection 20, 206 subsection 1 speaks about the duty of the ROC after forming an opinion to send a notice to the company concerned for the purposes of your for the purposes of getting an information and explanation. Then duty of the company and its officer to furnish the information to produce the document as asked for. So now once the notices has been received by the company, so it is the duty of the company and its officer both to furnish the information and the document as required for. So this section 2013 has carved out one important proviso in section 206 of subsection 2, that any of the past employee of the company, say suppose of the, if ROC is asking about any of the information which relates to the past event, or when the that particular director or say officer concerned is not attached to the company right now, so even they are still liable to give an information. So the proviso says where such information or explanation relates to any past period. So it may so happen that any 2 years, 3 years back, the information, say a continued chain of transaction has been occurring. So with respect to any previous transactions also, if the ROC asks for an information, so that has to be provided, and even the past person, past employees, past creditors and officers of the company will be responsible to provide the information. Then if defaulted, so if they have defaulted to comply with the provision, so they are punishable under section 206 subsection 7. So if the company is defaulting in providing the information, or the officers concerned are defaulting in providing the information, so they have to be, that will be punishable under section subsection 7. Past employees we have already covered. Then coming to section 206. So 201 basically was a first notice given by the ROC. Now again you will see under section 206, again there is a second notice which is given by the registrar of companies. What is that? Let us see. If no information, so the company has altogether kept mum and not replied to the notice. So if no information is furnished after first notice, so first notice is under subsection 1, or inadequate, or what you have provided, you have just, say suppose a registrar of companies may have asked for last 3 years bank statement, or say last 3 years ledger account of that particular company, or say 3 years balance sheet of that particular company, or say whatsoever may be. So in that situation, if you have only provided for a 1 year, or say incomplete 2 months, 3 months, 4 months is missing, or in that situation inadequate information, or on unsatisfactory state of affairs is in existence in the company, and the company is not disclosing a full and fair statement of the information required. So now this particular third part is important, unsatisfactory state of affairs. So the state of affairs is basically the affairs or the kind in which the company is put to run. So basically maintenance of a company, maintaining a company, running a company, running a business. So that is what, unsatisfactory state of affairs. So a financial statement speaks a lot about the company. So even the ROC very well can make out about the state of affairs of the company by having a look at the financial statements or having a look at the number of forms filed by the company. So on basis of that, if no information is provided, inadequate information is provided, and if there is an unsatisfactory state of affairs is in existence in the company, then what happens? Again, the registrar will call for an information or to produce records for information. Then what ROC will do? ROC will ask, give a dedicated time. The dedicated officer will be allotted, deputy ROC or the joint ROC or whatever may be. So that will be allotted. And they will be then asked to produce or carry a record for the purpose of inspection by the officer concerned. Now, ROC to record reason before action under section 203 is not necessary to form part of a process. So now we have seen that in subsection 1, no reason has to be recorded by the ROC. So that will be on the basis of the opinion formed by the ROC. It may be a written opinion or maybe it on the basis of the examination of the documents or whatever may be. But in case of subsection 3, that notice has to be given with the reason. Not specifically the notice has to state the reason for sending so, but for their internal purpose, that reason has to be recorded by the ROC. And then after recording that reason, the notice has to be given to the company. That is with respect to the second notice, which will be sent under section 206, subsection 3. So this particular proviso was not there with respect to recording of the reason. So this has been introduced in 2013, Act 2013. Now, coming to section 206, subsection 4, this has a more deeper scope and has a more deeper inference into the inquiry part. So let us see. So subsection 4 is basically information or representation before the registrar of companies. So on the basis of information available with the ROC, representation made to the ROC by any person, the business of the company is carried on for a fraudulent or unlawful purpose. So as we have discussed, so now the essence of fraud, the thing of fraud is coming into the affairs of the company, the business of the company, unlawful purpose of the company. So that is what it is saying. On the basis of information available with the ROC, representation made to the ROC by any person, the business of the company is carried on for a fraudulent or unlawful purpose. So that is an important part, fraudulent or unlawful purpose, not in compliance with the provision of act, grievance of investors are not addressed. So ROC to inform the company of the allegations made against it by written order and may call for information to carry or any inquiry as it deems fit. So 201 and 203 was a continuation of that. 201 was the first notice, then 203. Now 204 is a separate notice which has been sent. So it has no linkage with that of that. So that is what it is saying. Again, on the basis of information available with the ROC and any representation made to ROC by any person. So here the jurisdiction of the ROC may be suo motu on the basis of the information available with the ROC. So even ROC can suo motu ask for an information, ask for records to be produced before the ROC. While in his study, it is found that there is a fraudulent or unlawful purpose. So this particular thing has to be kept in mind under subsection 4. That is, the business of a company is being carried on for a fraudulent or unlawful purpose, but not in compliance with the provision of the code. So these are the particular three criteria which is there in the bold: fraudulent or unlawful, not in compliance with the provision, and grievance of investor. So here the information will be called for by the registrar of companies for the purpose of carrying out the inquiry as it deems fit. Now here in this subsection, there is a proviso with respect to this. Subsection 4, opportunity of being heard to the company is mandatory for the action under subsection 4. So before the launch of any prosecution or any investigation proceedings, since there is a talk of fraudulent and unlawful purpose, so there may be a chances that the department may refer the matter to the central government or to say to the SFIO or say to the tribunal for the purposes of investigation. So before that, the opportunity of being heard to be given to the company under section 206 subsection 4. Now, the central government can also direct the registrar or an inspector appointed to carry out the inquiry under section 206 and 4. So here, if the central government is satisfied, the central government can direct either the registrar or the inspector, a specific inspector which will be appointed for the purpose of carrying the inquiry under section 206 subsection 4. So the purpose of carrying out the inquiry under section 206-204, we have already seen the fraudulent unlawful purpose, grievances and provisions of the acts are not complied with and so on. Then punishment of fraud, that we are very well aware, since the section talks about the fraud. So the section 447 will be attracted here. So from the combined reading of subsection 4, so now let us see that what subsection 4 is specific, because subsection 4 is different from that of the earlier three sections. From the combined reading of subsection 4, the first proviso to the said subsection makes it amply clear that either ROC under his own suo motu jurisdiction or on the direction of the central government under the first provision of 206 subsection 4 is required to inform the company. So the central government, as I told you, that there are number of complaints which are also filed in the PG portal, and also the ministry is also active a number of times when the complaint is filed to the ministry directly to the secretary or whatever. In that instances also, it has been seen that the central government directs for the inquiry of the company. So there are two instances, suo motu and the direction of the central government, then is required to inform the company about the allegations made against it in writing and call on the company to furnish in writing any information or explanation on the matter specified in the notice and carry out such inquiry as he deems fit after providing a company an opportunity of being heard. So audi alteram partem, the company has to be provided with an opportunity of being heard. That has to be a written opportunity, not exactly a kind of which is given in a court, but in the format of a written opportunity where the company will be asked to reply to the notice received by the company. Then there are certain powers which are given to central government to order inspection and inquiry. So those powers, we have seen one power was given under proviso to section 206 subsection 4, which we have already talked about. Then 206 subsection 5 and 206 subsection 6 also gives a power to the central government. Let us see. In addition to the powers of registrar, the central government may direct the inspection, that we have seen. Coming to the second line, on being satisfied that the circumstances require such inspection, then may appoint inspector for the purpose of section 205. So the I have not quoted the verbatim of that particular section, but it's important for me to read this section. It is my mistake, I should have quoted, because this particular section is a non-obstant clause. I am just reading very slowly the subsection 5. Without prejudice to the foregoing provision of this section. So without prejudice to the foregoing provision of this section. So this is a non-obstant clause with respect to this section. So subsection 1, 2, 3 and 4. So subsection 5 is a non-obstant clause and it is an overriding. The central government may, if it is satisfied that the circumstances so warrant, direct inspection of books and papers of the company by an inspector appointed by it for the purpose of for the purpose. So what is the unusual thing here under subsection 5 is that no notice, central government direct the investigation into the particular affairs of the company, inspection of books of accounts of the company without calling for a preliminary inquiry. So this is a kind of a little vague section, subsection, that is 206 subsection 5, which is again having a wide and a far reaching impact on the companies when they receive notices under section 206 and 205, because this, as I told you, this may land up to a prosecution, this may land up to a criminality, there may be a prosecution launched against the company and its director, there may be SFIO or a dedicated look into the affairs of the company can be ordered. So the one has to very well deal with this replies and this particular situations and notices, because if anything which has been missed out, this will form a primary document for your further investigations, what reply you give under section 206. So that's why a very detailed reply, and after analyzing and after seeing all the provisions of the Companies Act and other applicable statutes, one has to draft a reply. Then central government may buy. So as I told you, subsection 5 is a non-obstant clause with respect to this section only. The earlier four sections has nothing to do when the subsection 5 comes into a play, and no notice is required. Directly a inquiry and inspection of books of accounts is ordered by the central government. Then subsection 6, central government may by special or general order authorize any statutory authority to carry out the inspection of books of accounts of a company or class of companies. So a number of situations, as I have written, that RBI in case of NBFCs, National Housing Board in case of housing finance companies. So even the central government may direct them to probe into the affairs of the company and the inspection of books of accounts of the company, more specifically to other departments. Then what is the penal provision for disobedience of inquiry orders? So the penal provision is company and every officer in a default with fine up to rupees 1 lakh. If a default continues, additional fine which may extend to rupees 500 for every day after the first during which the default continues. So we have already seen that if you have been asked for the information and no information is provided, then again in subsection 3 you have asked for information, no information is provided. So that will be a disobedience of the inquiry orders, and the penal provision is attracted pursuant to section 206 subsection 7. So this was about the inquiry part, the power to call for information. Now coming to the conduct of inquiry and inspection, that is section 206. Now this particular section imposes a obligation on every director, officer or other employee to produce all such documents and furnish such statement in such form as required and render assistance. So this will cast a duty and an obligation both on the officers of the company to provide the documents and the information as asked for. So that has to be done by the company. Even the employees of the company and officer will also include the statutory auditors of the company. So even the auditors are, as I told you, that in the notices, the auditors are also being served the copy of that notices. So you will find two, the name of the company, then below CC2, number of director 2, 3, 4, if there are 4 directors, then the auditors of the company. So even the auditors are marked CC to the notices and asking for a reply to that. So it may either be a joint reply or it may either be, so auditor may be reply to their interest regarding the audit observation or that thing. So that is again a subject matter of discussion that will form a separate subject matter of a discussion regarding the reply. Then the registrar or the investigating officer, all the due powers to conduct the inquiry and inspection under section 2. So this particular registrar or the investigation officer, as we have seen that the central government will employ a dedicated investigating officer. It may either be from a Delhi or from a ministry or maybe from a dedicated ROC personnel from the ROC, local ROC office. So that particular registrar or IO will have all the due powers to conduct the inquiry and inspection under section 206 and empowered to take copies, mark identification. So all the copies of the documents whenever the officer or the registrar will conduct an inquiry, so he may take the photocopy of the information and mark the copies with the identification mark with respect to the books of accounts or the document which he may think that may be required in future for any of the inquiry or investigation. Then the registrar IO empowered with the power of civil code under the code of civil procedure code in the matter. So now one can imagine the power which has been given to the registrar and IO with respect to conducting this inquiry and inspection. So they have been given a power of the civil court under CPC. So what are the power? Let us see. Discovery and production of books of accounts and records, summoning and enforcing the attendance of person and examination of oath, and inspection of any books, records at any place. The inspection of any books of records in any place. So these are basically the four. These are the basically three broad powers which have been given to the registrar or the IO with respect to the inquiry and inspection under this section. Then again, we have non-compliance, which I have not made part of this particular slide. Then coming to this penal provision, so let us miss out because we will, I think we will be short of time. So I'm just leaving this penal provision. So section 30, the power of order to discover. So these are the power which is given to the registrar of companies with respect to the CPC. So I have produced the section from the CPC itself. Then coming to section 208, report on inquiry and inspection. So now the registrar or the inspector have to give a report on inquiry under section 206 and inspection under section 207. So the report has to be given, and the registrar and inspector is duty bound to submit report to the central government along with all the documents. So all the document is basically your annexures or the photocopies of the document which has been taken by the registrar or the IO during the inspection. Say suppose bank account statement, ledger accounts, your contracts with any of the lender, share purchase agreement or whatever may be. So all those document will form part of the report, and that will be submitted to the central government. Empowered to recommend. Now this is important. Empowered to recommend investigation into the affairs of the company with reason. So they are empowered to recommend. So it is not necessarily that it will end up into an investigation, but if they smell that there is something which requires more deeper action, which requires a deep examination, and they can find out that there is the kind of economic offenses, the huge amount of money stake is involved, in that situation the recommendation is given regarding the investigation into the affairs of the company, and then the report has to be submitted as per the pro forma specified for the inspection. So that is with respect to your report. So I'm not going into the report that the what is exactly serially numbered and all that. So this is there. So this portion 209 is more of search and seizure. I am also leaving this particular section. So now coming to this particular section of investigation. So section 2010 is basically with respect to investigation into the affairs of a company. So now we have seen section 206, 207, 208. That was with respect to inquiry and inspection. So now we'll see investigation. So as I told you, investigations are held in number of sections like section 2110, 213 and 216. So and SFIO is a separate agency which is looking after the investigation. That is again an investigation, but it has to be done by a special agency, that is SFIO. So let us first concentrate on what is investigation under section 210. Central government on forming an opinion may order investigation on receipt of report of registrar or inspector under section 208. So we have already seen that there will be a recommendation by the registrar or the inspector. So that will form part of ordering an investigation by the central government. So on receipt of report of registrar or inspector under section 208. On intimation of special resolution passed by the company. So the company majority of the shareholder, so they have made out that the company is not running. Say suppose directors are not running the companies for the object for which it was formed and not in the interest of the shareholders of the company. So there the corporate democracy will come into the play, and the special resolution will be passed where the shareholders will pass the special resolution for the purpose of referring it to the investigation to the central government. Then in the public interest, so as I told you that the public interest, if there is any public interest, it may be a financial interest, maybe it can be a non-financial interest as well, where the investigation can be ordered into the affairs of the company. Now, so the situation here is such that it may order investigation. I have made the word may as a bold. So there is no obligation. It is not such that it is mandatory after giving a report to by the registrar or the inspector that the central government has to order an investigation. So that is not a case or any special resolution passed or whatever may be. So that may depend upon the case to case basis and fact to fact basis or on the preliminary study of the central government. So there is no obligation on the part of the government that once this three bullet will come into the play, the central government will necessarily order for the investigation. So it is may, no obligation is there. Then the central government shall order investigation on order passed by the court or the tribunal. So now the word here is shall with respect to the order if passed by any of the court or the tribunal. So this is with respect to the power given to the NCLT for the purposes of the investigation. So the central government will order investigation on the basis of the order passed by the court or the tribunal. And the central government, now what happens when the central government will order for an investigation? The central government may appoint one or more inspector to investigate into the affairs of the company and report in the manner as directed by the central government. So as we have seen there, that there will be a targeted targeted area where the investigation will be focused on. So it is not like that A to Z of the company will be covered for the purposes of investigation, but only those specific areas. It may be, say, suppose a financial bank account of the company where the company was a liquid company, or something has to be unearthed. Say, suppose it was the company was into the accommodation entries. So that has to be revealed out. So it was a sham company. So from the that perspective, the investigation has to be ordered and has to be carried out by the inspector or the investigation personnel who will be appointed by the central government. So appointment of inspector that we have seen, section 210 subsection 3, the CG may appoint so and so. If material on record prima facie shows that the fraud has been played, so I have already told you about the first bullet, the CG may appoint one or more person as inspector to report there in such manner as may be directed by the CG. Then if material on record prima facie shows that fraud has been played and committed to cause a loss to the company, investigation could be ordered. So as I told you that as soon as there is a prima facie finding of the central government or the registrar of the companies or the inspector, so if there is any intent or any cause which will show that the fraud has been played upon the stakeholders of the company, so you may very well make it out that definitely there will be an investigation which will be ordered. Now, what is basically the affairs of the company? Because multiple places you will find that the word affairs of the company has been placed, and more specifically when dealing with the investigation. So affairs of the company will mean the investigation of all its business affairs like profit and losses, assets including goodwill, contracts and transactions, investments and other property interest, and control of subsidiary companies as well. So it may so happen that the investigation can only be ordered with respect to assets, any asset of the company, if any asset of the company is being misutilized or has been any complaint has been made to the registrar of companies with respect to misutilization or transfer of asset of the company at a lower price, stamp duty is not paid with respect to the adequate amount. So number of instances, then any contracts and transactions, if any with related party or if any of the foreign subsidiaries or whatever may be not at arm's length price. So there are number of situations in which a targeted investigation can be ordered with respect to that. Then again, the subsidiaries companies are also covered. So it is not that if the notice is only directed to X limited company, then Y limited, Z limited being a subsidiary will be out of that. No, it is not that. So if a holding company has been given a notice, so it may also happen that even the investigation can be done for the subsidiary companies as well by the inspectors and the investigating officers. So this was one of the judgment part with respect to your section 212. We'll deal with section 212, that SFIU will come into place. So now investigation, we are coming into SFIO section 2110. We have discussed about the investigation into the affairs of the company at the behest of the central government. Now investigation into the affairs of the company by SFIO. So I must tell you that this SFIO has found place in Companies Act under section 2013. Even though there was a SFIO through a circular, there was a department, or there was a officers which were given a position under the SFIO under 1956 Act, but there was no specific sections dealing with the provisions of SFIO. But this Companies Act 2013 has find a place, specific sections which deal with the purposes of section SFIO. Now, the statutory body setup has been given under section 211. Then the powers of the SFIU and the conduct and everything is given from 2112 to 224. And powers of arrest. So the SFIU has been given a power to arrest. So directly they can arrest the person behind the scene regarding the by the SFIU officers. And search and seizure under section 217, and this particular investigation and SFIO, more specifically, if one will go through the summaries of these cases, they will find out that these are the cases which has been dealt by the SFIO more deep into ILFS, Bhushan Steel, Rotomac, Rockland Hospital is the most recent one where the SFIO has probed into. Now, establishment of SFIO, I'm just quickly dealing with the subheading. SFIO gets a statutory status and organization under section 211. Deals about this section, particularly deals about the composition of the SFIU, that who will form part of an SFIU. So now SFIU is a separate office, like ROC is a separate office, RD is a separate office. The SFIU is also a separate office, though it is under the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, but all the management dealings and roles and responsibilities of SFIU is different from that of the ROC and RD and other offices, oil office like that. So it is one of the office under the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. Then appointment of members, appointment of directors. So there are specialized members, expert members who will form part of the, who will be an officer of the SFIO. This sections lay about the terms and conditions of the services, and the expertise persons from different field has to be appointed into this particular SFIO for the purposes of your carrying out the functions of investigations. So coming on to section 212 with respect to investigation. So if you will go to special court, which has been formed for the purposes of the Companies Act, which deals with respect to the criminal breach of this particular provisions of the Companies Act, where the cognizable offenses are there and the offenses which may culminate into prosecution. So you will find that now the SFIO has come into play, and the SFIO, even the ministry is also made this particular department more active, because in this economy, number of businesses are going, lot of NPAs and lot of financial breakdowns are happening into the company, which requires a great analysis and a deeper intersection of the companies as what has led to such a position of the company. So this dedicated SFIO was formulated for the purposes of looking into the investigation. So this is unlike the investigation done by the registrar of companies, done by the investigating officers. This is an office in itself, which itself has a various powers and a capacity, that SFIO in its own name can file an application to the special court for the purposes of arresting a person, for the purposes of lending a prosecution and everything. So let us very briefly deal about section 212. I am parallelly also seeing the time, it is already 6:15. So I not have much of the time and number of sections are yet to be discussed. So coming on to section 212, investigation by SFIU. So this particular, as I told you that this particular section is again a code in itself. So if one has to, if any of the client or any of the company is coming into the purview of SFIU, so the one has to refer this particular section from the Companies Act. So there may be number of sections which one may have to refer from CRPC, like CRPC 167 for getting a bail, 439, 438, 437, anticipatory bail and everything. So that are again a different, we are not getting into that particular criminal offenses part and how to get a bail and everything, but we will stick our discussion with respect to the Companies Act. So as I told you that 212 in itself is a code and lays a procedure which a SFIO has to undertake while investigating the matters. So provides a statutory status to SFIO. So SFIO gets a statutory recognition through section 212 and 211. Now, it is without prejudice to the provision of section 2110. As I already told you that that investigation is different from that of the investigation which is ordered under ordered by the SFIO. So it is again without prejudice to the provision of section 210. The central government is again empowered to order investigation by SFIO. So now that is the say a option, or that is a at the will of the central government. So they will analyze on the basis of the facts of the case that whether this particular company or whether this particular case requires attention of the SFIO, or this will itself be done by the competent investigation officers or the registrar of companies itself. So that is at the discretion of the central government. The matter will be referred to the your SFIO. So what are the conditions to that effect? On receipt of report of registrar inspector under section 208. So what is the scope which is coming into? We have seen inquiry inspection. Now that inquiry inspection, the report is prepared under section 208. The central government is served with the copy of that particular report. And if the central government feels that no, this investigation can be ordered under section 210, then 210, no, this investigation requires a great view where a specialized department or a specialized office has to be given the task, then it is referred under the SFIU. Or on the intimation of the special resolution passed by the company, and especially passed by the company, and its affairs are required to be investigated. So there are a number of situations where even the majority shareholders, and I told you majority stakeholders, oftenly pass an information to investigate the company. At instances we have seen in NCLT also that some of the directors or some of the shareholders, more particularly in group of the shareholders, try to get hold of the company, try to dictate the company. So these are the particular rescue provisions which are provided under the Companies Act. So to deal with such a situation which was earlier not there. So one can tell out that this is a part of corporate governance which the companies have carved out, and the tools which have been given to the stakeholders to get the company investigated by the central government directly by the SFIO if there is a fraud involved in the company. So in the public interest and on request from any department. So there in subsection 10, it was not there on request from any department or central government, but here you will find that on request from any department of the central government or state government. So it may so happen that any of the department may refer the matter to the central government for the purposes of investigation. So the investigation will be ordered to SFIO. The CG by order, central government by order, assign the director SFIO to designate the inspector. So the central government will assign it to the director, the topmost post of the SFIO. And then the SFIO will designate the officers who will be reporting to the directors of the SFIO. once the investigation is ordered by the CG for SFIU, no other, this is important. So this was not there earlier. So like we have section 14 under the IBC, a kind of a moratorium where the RP takes on the charge and no disturbance from everything comes to a stay, and a single RP will look into every pending matters, pending suits and everything. So in similar on that note, there is a provision with respect to an understanding can be drawn from there. I should not say similar, but just to draw an understanding. Once an investigation is ordered by the CG for SFIU, no other agency to investigate matters under this act and shall transfer the relevant records to the SFIU. So, एक बार यदि SFIU के हाथ में चला गया तो आप कोई भी दूसरा डिपार्टमेंट, बीट ईडी, बीट सीबीआई, बीट एनी ऑफ द कस्टम और वट एवर, आई एम नॉट सॉरी कस्टम इज नॉट देयर बिकॉज दैट इज विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द टैक्सेशन पार्ट, बट एनी अदर डिपार्टमेंट, PMLA और वट एवर मे बी हु इज लुकिंग आफ्टर द इकोनॉमिक ऑफेंसेज, नॉट फ्रॉम द टैक्सेशन पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू. सो दे हैव टू ट्रांसफर द मैटर्स टू द all the proceedings to the SFIU to focus on that. So that all the relevant records or what all the workings has been done by those department, so that also needs to be transferred to the SFIU. So what message this section gives is that the SFIU will become the nodal agency. So SFIU will become the supreme agency who will be investigating into the affairs of the company from all the angles to make out whether there was a fraud played over the stakeholders or not. So now coming to, so there was a judgment with respect to the manner and procedures with respect to time specified for the completion of investigation. So there was a Supreme Court judgment which says that, I have copied the exact judgment, that what, because in section 212 you will nowhere find any time limit given for the purposes of giving any reports or completion of the investigation. But so what the section Supreme Court says, the Supreme Court held that the time period is only directory in nature, so there is no mandatory timeline provided to it. So it may so happen that an investigation may go for 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, because oftenly you will find that in such a situation where the economic offenses, white collar crimes are involved, number of directors are in jail. Even in Calcutta NCLT, some of the matters which are pending, you will find that some of the directors are in jail, and there is a very difficult for the officers, court officers or the resolution professionals to get on an information from them and then to streamline the work. So similar is the case here in those situations where multiple legislations are already in part and already the person has been convicted or undergoing any investigation in any of the statutes. So it is not possible if a dedicated timeline is given. So that's why they have made it a directory in nature. And what the court held was, the stipulation in section subsection 3 of section 212 act regarding the submission of the report to the central government within such period as may be specified in the order. So what happens, the SFIU director gives an order to the inspectors to investigate into the affairs of the company. So now in that order, looking into the affairs of the company and looking into the state of that company, they may order for investigation. So it is depend upon the fact of the case, fact to fact basis. It may so happen that if it is a small company, the amount of money or the amount of scale of business involved is very low, less. So it may so happen that a 3 months time may be given. But if there is a multiple layer companies, there are multiple associate companies, subsidiaries companies, where the investigation will travel to say a long period, number of locations the inspector has to travel, number of places the inspector has to travel. So that's why this particular things will require more time. So that's why they have made it directory, and the officer has to stipulate a time purely into the order where they will grant give a direction to the inspector to investigate. power of arrest under section 2128 act conferred upon the director, additional director at any time and so long as the conditions stipulated in subsections are satisfied, the power of arrest can be validly exercised. So this also speaks about the power of arrest, because as long as the investigation will go on, the clock is still running, the clock of SFIU is still running in the company. So the power of arrest can also be exercised in any period. So there is no limitation that once the order for investigation is passed, the arrest has to be done on that particular day or within 3 months or 6 months or whatever may be, because this has been a subject matter of litigation in number of matters. And this particular section has traveled, section 212 subsection 6 and 8 has traveled to Supreme Court as well. And there is still an anomaly with that respect with regarding the bail and arrest of this, because it is having a conflicting view with respect to the PMLA and other sections. So that is again a separate set of discussions. So what I was telling is that the limitation is extended with respect to powers of arrest in this section. So the investigation may go for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, maybe down the line. So that is why the power or limitation with respect to arrest is also accordingly being extended or enlarged. Then appointment of IO and the powers, what are the powers that will be there with respect to IO is there under section 217. And again, here in section in SFIU also, the obligation is both on the present and the past employees, officers of the company to provide the information. So under subsection 5, there is a obligation casted both upon the past employees, present employees and officers of the company to provide for the information. Yes. So coming to subsection 6, as I was speaking about subsection 6, this is about the particularly the situation of bail and arrest, basically under section under SFIU. There are certain offenses which are cognizable, and no person accused of such offenses shall be released on bail. So this section creates a restriction with respect to getting a bail. So the Companies Act have a number of sections which are cognizable in nature, and with respect to that, there are restrictions on taking a bail. So there are two conditions which are provided into this particular section for granting of bail under SFIO. So there is one carve out given in this section that the person who is under the age of 16 years or is a woman or is a sick or infirm may be released on bail if the special court so directs. So as I told you, special court word is used here. So this application with respect to arrest and launching of a prosecution will lie before the special court. So almost in every state, there is a special court dedicated for this particular company affairs, where the district judges and magistrates are form quorum for that particular court and who deals with the matters of this nature. Then powers of arrest are there in subsection 8 as well, that what is the power of arrest given to the SFIO for the purposes of investigation. So there are certain situations, certain points where the powers are given to the officers under the SFIO to arrest the person concerned. So no limitation to proceed under section under 212. So there is no limitations for proceeding, because the fraud, in case of fraud and anything, there is no limitation that if the opinion has been formed 2 year, 1 year, 2 year, 3 years back, then when can the this particular things be launched. So that is not the case. So no limitation has been prescribed for the purposes of this. So this is one recent judgment with respect to not so recent of 2009, Vikas Agarwal versus Serious Fraud. So what has happened in the judgment? Let us see. Upon hearing and perusal of impugned order, material on record and relevant provision of the Companies Act, judge, it means the court has found that the definition of fraud provided in explanation of the Companies Act makes it clear that the prosecution is to relate to the companies in the first instance and also to other persons who have in any manner connived in commission of the offense to gain undue advantage. So even the person concerned and any of the other person, officer and employees of the company is also, if acted in connivance to get an undue advantage, so they will also be trapped under the prosecution of this section. A bare perusal of section 212 of the Companies Act reveals that there is no bar of limitation to proceed under section 212 or 447 of the Companies Act. What is larger conspiracy cannot be prejudged at the initial stage and is required to be examined at the trial stage. So अब कोई इतना बड़ा स्कैम है और इतना बड़ा कॉन्स्पिरेसी जो चला आ रहा है, देर आर नंबर ऑफ लेयर्स एंड नंबर ऑफ प्लानिंग प्लॉटिंग विच हैज बीन डन एंड लेड टू दिस पब्लिक इकोनॉमी डिस्ट्रक्शन. सो इन दैट सिचुएशन इट कैनॉट बी प्री जज एट द इनिशियल स्टेज. सो इट रिक्वायर अ डिटेल्ड ट्रायल इन्वेस्टिगेशन ऑफ दैट अफेयर्स एट द समनिंग स्टेज. लिमिटेड स्क्रूटनी इज रिक्वायर्ड टू बी अंडरटेकन. सो लिमिटेड स्क्रूटनी व्हाट वी हैव सीन at the stage of inquiry, and inspection, the limited scrutiny will be undertaken. And later on, upon doing so, the court finds that no illegality or infirmity in the impugned order. The court finds that a trial court had jurisdiction to proceed against the petitioner as sanction for the prosecution has already been taken. In the considered opinion of the court, the trial does not lack the jurisdiction to proceed against the petitioner. So this was the subsequent part was about the jurisdiction. Maybe the petitioner must have challenged the jurisdiction of the court regarding the proceeding. So that is what it is saying, that the court find that the trial court has the jurisdiction to proceed with the case of the hand. So that is why it has been ordered. So what was the takeaway was with respect to the limitation part, that there is no bar on limitation to proceed under section 212 and 447 of the Companies Act. So how much time do I have, Vishnu bhaiya?
Sir, aapka jo bataye aapki jo ichha ho waise karenge sir.
So maybe I'll just sum up in next 15 minutes,
then we can have a discussion on any issues in any case laws or any chat if you find anything.
Yes, in 15 minutes. So now what is the this particular steps I have carved out, that what happens, the how it culminate into a SFIO proceedings. First, what happened, the complaint is lodged. It may be lodged by any person, it may be a shareholder, it may be any of the director, any of the parties, any third person, any creditor, any stakeholder. Then what happened, in the exercise of powers conferred in subsection 1 and 3 of the Companies Act, the opinion is formed. Then what happens, the investigation into the affairs of the company takes place. Investigation officer is appointed, investigation report to be submitted to the MCO, MCA, and granted direction to initiate prosecution against the accused. So the this particular 4-5 steps which I have jotted down is a gist of section 212, that complaint, exercise of power 212-213, opinion has to be formed, investigation into the affairs of the company, appointing of the order of investigation into the affairs of the company, appointing of the investigation officer. So as I told you, the director will appoint the investigation officers. Now that investigation officer has to submit first a preliminary report, then a final report, which has to be submitted to the MCA. And then on the basis of that report, what MCA will do, that is Union of India, will initiate a prosecution against the accused. So that is the thing. So coming to this, so this was one of the judgment which is most quoted, which I have found commonly in number of judgment when I was scrolling through the SFIO part. Some observation was made with respect to the your economic offenses. So let us see what observation. So it was Chief Minister that Y.S. Jagmohan Reddy case versus CBI. So what was the observation? Let us see. The economic offenses constitute a class apart and need to be visited with a different approach in the matter of bail. So now this is with respect to section 212 subsection 6, bail in case of an SFIO investigation. So as we all know that in economic offenses constitute a class apart and need to be visited with a different approach in the matter of bail. The economic offenses have been deep rooted conspiracies and involve huge loss of public funds bank's money and need to be viewed seriously and considered as a grave offense affecting the economy of the country as a whole and thereby posing a serious threat to the financial health of the company. So now what we can imagine that what is the impact on the economy of the company country as well when there is a economic offenses come into our found. So in such situation, while granting a bail, the court has to keep in mind the nature of accusations. So what accusations or the charges have been leveled, the nature of evidence in support thereof, the severity of the punishment which conviction will entail. So the nature of charges, evidence in support thereof, severity of the punishment, that what is the severity of the punishment if the charges is proved, the character of the accused, circumstances which are peculiar to the accused, reasonable possibility of securing the presence of the accused at the trial, reasonable apprehension of the witness being tempered, the large interest of public, state and other similar conditions. So now this is basically an underlying section, paragraph 34 and 35, which has to be kept in mind while kept in mind by the special courts while granting a bail. That this the court has to keep in mind. So this is a Supreme Court judgment. So as per Article 142, the judgment of the Supreme Court has to be all courts have to follow that. So that is what it is saying, that if any economic offenses are found out and if any prayer for a bail or an application for bail is made in a special court, so then what is an angle within which a judicial officer has to look at the case? So that is what it has given in paragraph 35. So section 213, so now I am coming, taking over to section 213. So we have quickly covered 212 because 212 again required a detailed discussion. As I told you that 2 hours will not, I will not be able to do justice to this particular topic. But as the topic itself was a peek into, so a peek into maybe a quick revision of this, quick go through to this topic. So now coming to section 213, investigation into the affairs of the company in other cases. So there are certain other cases where the investigation of the companies are ordered. And here under section 213, NCLT has a power to order for an investigation. So even we are practicing before NCLT, and in section 241, 242 operation mismanagement matter, we are filing a combined petition with section 213. So it is permissible under the NCLT practices that number of sections can be combined petition is maintainable for operation and mismanagement. So if there is a cases of operation and mismanagement where which is causing a prejudice to the shareholder or members of the company, oppressive to the shareholder, or and there is a mismanagement in the affairs of the company, so oftenly an investigation is also ordered by the tribunal. It may be investigation by a court appointed officer, or it may be investigation by the central government or the ROC, as we have seen. So there are number of authority which can conduct an investigation. So now there is a mandatory, say a locus or a criteria which a person has to satisfy in order to file an application before the tribunal for the purposes of investigation under this particular section. So first, for the members, so there is a percentage provided there in the first sub clause for the where there is a share shares in the company. And where there is a not a share in the company, so that is there in subclause 2. So now in any other cases, 23 subclause B, there are 3 subclauses dealing with the 3 distinct. So I am not going into the number part with respect to the qualification which one has to possess while filing an investigation application before the NCLT. So I am coming on to the second part basically. So 3 qualifications person meeting 3 qualifications can file an application under section 213. First is a shareholder or a member qualifying so and so, then company having no share capital, and then there is a class which is any other person or otherwise. So any other person is also allowed to file an application for investigation before the NCLT. So that is there in subclause this 3B, which deals with three distinct character where any other person can file an application. So the three distinct character are, I'm quickly taking it through, when the business of the company is being conducted with intent to defraud its creditors or unlawful purpose. So this is a common that you will find it everywhere in almost in every statutes as well. Then if there is any guilty of fraud, misfinance or other misconduct towards the company or towards any of its member, subclause 2. Then subclause 3, the members of the company have not been given all the information with respect to its affair which might reasonably expect, including information relating to calculation of commission payable to managing director or director. So in that, these are the three situations where an application may be made by any other person or otherwise for initiating an investigation by the tribunal. So again, here an opportunity of being heard has to be given after giving a sufficient opportunity of being heard, the investigation is ordered. So for ordering an investigation, the NCLT has to be satisfied first. So that is that onus is on the part of the petitioner or an applicant who is making an application under section 213, that the applicant has to prove that the business of the company is being conducted to defraud its creditors, and there is a case of fraud, misfinance or misconduct toward the company. So this onus is on the applicant or the petitioning shareholder or a member or a petitioning person to prove, then only the investigation under section 213 will be ordered. And you will find number of judgment with respect to section 213. It may be a single application where only section 213 applications are made, or it may be a combined application with the 214 and 242, section 59, 58, transfer transmission of shares and other sections of the Companies Act. So now I'll just discuss this last section. I'll just discuss, I'll close at 6:45, I'll close, because this is again a part of an investigation. So I'll just discuss this as a last section. So section 216, this is again about the investigation of ownership of company. So as you can see, ownership, matlab company ka malik kaun hai, uski jankari ke liye investigation kiya ja raha. Owner, real owner, who is the real owner, who is controlling or having a material influence in the company. वहां आपने देख रहे थे अफेयर्स के बारे में, अनलॉफुल पर्पस, बिजनेस के बारे में, ये सारे चीज के बारे में. बट यहाँ जो पर्पस ऑफ इन्वेस्टिगेशन है 216 में, दैट इज विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द ओनरशिप ऑफ द कंपनी. सो व्हाट इज इट, लेट अस सी. द सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट इम्पावर्ड टू अपॉइंट इंस्पेक्टर टू इन्वेस्टिगेट एंड रिपोर्ट ऑन मैटर रिलेटिंग टू कंपनी एंड इट्स मेंबरशिप. मेंबरशिप मतलब कौन? शेयर होल्डर्स. सो ये बेसिकली हु आर द मेंबर्स ऑफ द कंपनी, ओनर्स ऑफ द कंपनी. सो to determine the true person who is behind the scene, basically. So to check the control, that who is controlling the company and who is the person behind, who is managing the affairs of the company. So that is what it is saying, that central government empowered to appoint officer to investigate and report on matters relating to company and its membership to determine true persons who are or have been financially interested in the success or failure or real or apparent. So aisa bhi ho sakta hai ki bhale hi actual mein, this is about lifting of corporate veil, ki aap actual mein koi aur hai shareholder or director, but company ka profit or loss jo hai financially kisi aur ke affect kar raha hai. So that is what, who are or have been financially interested in the success or failure, whether real or apparent, who are or have been able to control or to materially influence the policy of the company. So ye sab aspect mein jo hai investigation will be ordered. And who are the beneficial owner of the company, who is managing the affairs of the company. Such investigation may be ordered by central government on the order by the tribunal specific to the membership of the company and other matters relating to the company. The CG may define scope of investigation. Now again, as I told you, ab investigation aisa nahi ki aap company ka certificate of incorporation se le karke abhi tak ka jitna document file hua aap sabko investigate. So that is not possible. So otherwise it will not be completed. So that is why it is always there, whenever an investigation will be ordered, depending upon the fact and circumstances, there will be a targeted investigation on a specific subject or in a specific line of activity or in a specific points of the company. So the CG may define the scope of investigation.
Rules, punishment of the difference, what is the paper?
Defined period or limit investigation to matter with particulars of shares and debentures. So this was with respect to section 216. So just last, I'll just discuss with this particular judgment of the Calcutta High Court with respect to Birla Corporation, where about the investigation they have dealt. This is a beautiful extract from that particular judgment. The sine qua non for passing an order of investigation by appointment of inspector is formation of opinion of necessity of such an investigation. कि इन्वेस्टिगेशन रिक्वायर्ड है उसकी नेसेसिटी का एक ओपिनियन फॉर्म होना चाहिए. देयर कैन बी नो डाउट दैट द ओपिनियन माइट बी सब्जेक्टिव बट एग्जिस्टेंस ऑफ सर्कमस्टेंसेज एंड और मटेरियल दैट जस्टिफाई द फॉर्मेशन बाय द ट्राइब्यूनल, आई कैन रिप्लेस सीएलबी विद द ट्राइब्यूनल टुडे, ऑफ प्राइमा फेसी ओपिनियन ऑफ द नेसेसिटी ऑफ एन इन्वेस्टिगेशन इनटू द इंटरेस्ट ऑफ द कंपनी. सो इट कैन आइदर बी सब्जेक्टिव but there has to be an instance or existence of a circumstance which should form a prima facie opinion for the purposes of necessitating the investigation into the affairs of the company and in public interest must be demonstrable. So ye aapko dikhana matlab the department has to, because the department will be initiating the particular investigation or say pursuant to the claim by any of the person. So that person has to prove, the onus will be that this affairs of the company is directly related or directly causing a prejudice to the public interest. So that has to be demonstrated. So the evidence has to speak that there is a influence on the public interest as well. The tribunal should not direct a roving fishing investigation. Aisa nahi ki wo roving fishing expedition pe investigation blindedly order kar dega ki jao aap company ko investigate karo. So that is not apprehended or maybe looked from by the tribunal. At the behest of the person who have some ulterior intent in seeking investigation. So aisa ho sakta hai ki there may be a situation that there somebody must be having a personal grudge or ego problem or whatever, maybe where the complaint has been filed and investigation has been ordered. So the CLB should not direct a investigation blindfoldedly the investigation, let investigation be carried on. So that ulterior motive has to be unearthed and has to be seen whether the motive is correct for the investigation or not. For example, to stop the shareholders from exercising their rights as a shareholder in including their right to vote as attempted in the instant case. So aisa ho sakta hai ki koi shareholder regarding the voting rights and everything. So that situation mein jahan pe koi shareholder has been deprived of his right or wahan pe yadi wo application file, that does not mean that the investigation will be ordered or any director has been removed from the company. So that cannot form a basis for filing an application under section 213 or 2110 or 2116 for investigation into the affairs of the company. So there has to be a material grounds to satisfy the tribunal. And it has to be a bona fide application. So I will rest my PPT here and we can take up the questions because already 6:48. There are a number of slides which are still left, but maybe we'll take up some other day. Yes, over to Ashubhya. Yes.
Of course, sir, you'll be called again on the other day. And if the things come in normal situations, of course the fiscal mode will be organized and you will be called upon once again to discuss about this matter. With the permission of speakers and the chairman and the audience, I want to raise one interesting question of the situation here, if the speakers permit me.
Yes, please.
Audience, please, normally, हम लोगों को एक प्रॉब्लम ये होती है कि जब कोई 23 एसी या एसीए बैलेंस शीट एनुअल रिटर्न जब जमा करते हैं तो तीन तरह की सिचुएशन क्रिएट होती है. One is that somebody has somebody could not attach the attachment. So could not give the attachment. Second situation is attachment was made, but it is not legible because it was not properly scanned. Third situation ये है कि in case of holding subsidiary company, there is application of CFS, but the column selected as not applicable. And the next time we are unable to attach the CFS. Now, what the ROC do? Because all these forms are STP, it is assets for processing. And in that case, it is not rejected, there will be wrong submission. And if it is to be revoked, then how to revoke? How to rectify it? Then I just so whether this will be called, this can be the situation to call for information by the ROC under Section 206. First yes. Condition. Second question. Continuously, this cannot be treated as a fraud. Yes, because as I feel subject to further correction by the speaker, because fraud is not defined in Company Act. Section 447, it is just saying that there must be some mens rea, there must be some culprit mind to take the advantage of that situation. Only then can be treated as a fraud. And in IBC, even the fraud has not been defined, but they have told about fraudulent transactions in different sections, section 43, 51, and to 66 to 67. So this is not a fraud. Now, ROC, can the ROC, such types of lapses by the professionals or by the client or by the stakeholders, can they convert 206 to 447? And what are the way out to correct this submission of form?
So see, if I told you that as the section 206 starts with, while on a scrutiny of any document filed by a company, so document kya hota hai, aap jo bhi form file kar rahe ho, whatever form you are filing, that is that there are certain attachments which forms part of the form. So that attachments is a part of a document. Aap basically form kya, form mein to aap documents ka summarized form of information aap form mein dal dete ho. Aapka jo document hai uska wo aap summarized form mein ki that is there, wahan pe unke jo checks and tricks hai wahan se wo, yadi unko koi information kahin pe wo filter mein yadi aa gaye to wahan se wo trap karke they can call for that. But as I told you that there has been a circular and notification also by the ministry that even the STP forms are also subject to scrutiny. So say suppose आपका दिनमान खराब है, आपने फॉर्म फाइल किया और आपके क्लाइंट का, आपका क्या मतलब क्लाइंट का जो होगा यहाँ तो क्लाइंट का ही होगा, तो क्लाइंट का सपोज करिए कि यदि वो आपने जो एक फॉर्म फाइल किया और वहां पे मे बी इफ इट इज एन इलेजिबल और मे बी एक्स वाई जेड रीजन और वट एवर मे बी, आपने जो जैसे बताया कि वो कोई एरर हो गया, यदि स्कैनिंग ठीक से नहीं हुई, प्रॉपर अनक्लियर हो गया और वट एवर मे बी, तो वहां पे यदि आपका स्क्रूटिनी में आ गया और इन्फॉर्मेशन आरओसी ने कॉल फॉर कर लिया, तो जैसे मैंने बताया इट इज नॉट नेसेसरीली दैट द इंक्वायरी विल लैंड अप टू एन इन्वेस्टिगेशन और इंक्वायरी विल लैंड अप टू एन फर्दर इंक्वायरी और डिटेल्ड सबसेक्शन 3 जो मैं आपको बता रहा था. इट मे सो हैपन दैट आपका यदि वहां पे कोई क्वेरी आया, सो दैट इज ओके, दैट इज वेलकम, सिंस आपको पता था कि वहां पे ये चीज हुआ है, सो यू मस्ट हैव ऑलरेडी नोन दैट ऐसा आ सकता है. So what you can do is in case of if inquiry yadi usi respect mein hai, so they may, what ROC will do, ROC will ask for a fresh attachment, matlab wo fresh aapse wapis balance sheet jo hai usme mang lega, because already bahut sari information to aapke MGT 7 aur AOC 4 mein available rehti hai, wahan pe bahut sare figures already jate hai, board meeting ke details hai, sari financial indebtedness wali details hai, abhi jo hai amendment aa gaya, indebted wale figures nahi jayenge, indebtedness wale, but lekin बहुत सारे मेजर इन्फॉर्मेशन फ्रॉम द पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू ऑफ द आरओसी डिपॉजिट्स वाले है, नंबर ऑफ मीटिंग्स है, नंबर ऑफ शेयर होल्डर्स है, ये सारे वहां पे रहते हैं. तो उस बेसिस पे यदि आरओसी सेटिस्फाई हो जाता है तो ओके, और यदि नहीं सेटिस्फाई होता है सो दे मे कॉल फॉर एन इंफॉर्मेशन टू द कंपनी और वहां पे दे मे आस्क फॉर अगेन सर्विंग देम अ कॉपी ऑफ अ बैलेंस शीट और अ फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट. सो इट इज नॉट नेसेसरी कि वहां पे जो है, इफ दैट इज वाई मैंने आपको बताया कि यदि वो रिप्लाई जो फर्स्ट नोटिस आता है यदि उसका रिप्लाई वहां पे अच्छे तरीके से मैनेज हो जाए, डिटेल्ड, वेयर यू आर एबल टू सेटिस्फाई आरओसी विद रिस्पेक्ट टू हिज रिक्वायरमेंट, विद रिस्पेक्ट टू हिज कंसर्न, विद रिस्पेक्ट टू हिज क्वेश्चन, और उसकी जो इच्छुकता है उसको आप यदि सेटिस्फाई कर देते हो तो दैट विल डेफिनेटली नॉट कम इन टू द वे ऑफ कमिंग इन टू अ फ्रॉड, नेट ऑफ अ फ्रॉड और व्हाट, बिकॉज वो तो देखिए गलती एक क्लरिकल एरर भी है और एक इंटेंशनली भी है. अब वो वहां पे आप अपना एक इंटेंशन प्रूव कर सकते हो यदि आप 10 फॉर्म फाइल किए हो और वो 10 फॉर्म में आपका यदि वो एक ही फॉर्म में स्कैनिंग मिस्टेक है तो दैट इज देयर, और आपके बाकी में यदि सही है तो दैट इज अ कोर्स ऑफ एक्शन एंड 100% अ वैलिड आर्ग्यूमेंट विच कैन बी पुट बिफोर द आरओसी व्हाइल सब्सटेंशिएटिंग योर केस। एंड उसमें फिर वे आउट है, योर वॉइस इज नॉट कमिंग, यू आर ऑन अ म्यूट।
या द सेकंड लिंब ऑफ द सेम सिचुएशन इज दैट हाउ टू अपडेट माय इनकंप्लीट इंफॉर्मेशन व्हिच वाज फाइल्ड इन एओसी 4 व्हिच इज एसटीपी।
देखिए कंप्लीट इनकंप्लीट इंफॉर्मेशन मतलब मैं समझा नहीं, एक बार इफ यू कैन जस्ट थोड़ा सा और डिटेल में क्वेश्चन। हां
हां, फॉर एग्जांपल आई वाज टू स्कैन 20 डॉक्यूमेंट्स बट आई लेफ्ट टू स्कैन द शेड्यूल, आई लेफ्ट टू स्कैन और अटैच द वन पार्ट ऑफ द शेड्यूल, दिस इज इनकंप्लीट। तो और सपोज आई वाज टू अटैच द बैलेंस शीट ऑफ ए, इट वाज अटैच्ड बैलेंस शीट ऑफ बी, दिस इज रॉन्ग।
यस,
सो हाउ द पर्सन विल गेट द विल अपडेट दिस सिचुएशन बिफोर द आरओसी।
See, एक तो देखिए आपके पास इसमें थोड़े टेक्निकलिटी से अपना फैक्ट को देखना पड़ेगा, पहले क्लाइंट की प्रॉब्लम को समझना पड़ेगा। एक तो अपने पास सेक्शन अवेलेबल है सेक्शन 131 जो बोलता है वॉलंटरी रिवीजन ऑफ फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट्स और बोर्ड रिपोर्ट, तो वो सेक्शन 131 अवेलेबल है, मैं उसमें बाद में आता हूँ, पहले अपने बाईपास रूट निकालते हैं कि बाईपास रूट क्या है। तो एक बाईपास रूट अवेलेबल है कि आप बैकएंड से जाते हो, वो इंटरनल है, दैट इज नॉट इन लॉ बट इट इज रेगुलरली प्रैक्टिस बिफोर द आरओसी। तो उनके पास भी सर्कुलर है, डायरेक्शन है, और अभी उनका डेडिकेटेड सर्कुलर आ गया कि आप GNL 2 में आप अपना वो फाइल करोगे एफिडेविट के साथ कि आप किस लिए वो SRN को कैंसिल करवाना चाह रहे हो और आप नए फॉर्म को फाइल करोगे। सो दैट इज अ बाईपास रूट अवेलेबल टू यू, जहाँ पे आपको यदि लगे कि नहीं फ्रॉम द पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू ऑफ अ बेटर कॉर्पोरेट गवर्नेंस और बेटर बिजनेस एथिक्स, यदि आपका कोई मिस इन्फॉर्मेशन जा रहा है और आपको इन्फॉर्मेशन जो है डिटेल्ड इन्फॉर्मेशन ये डिस्क्लोज होना चाहिए था सो एज टू सेव योर कंपनी फ्रॉम अ फ्यूचर लिटिगेशन और दैट, बिकॉज देखिए आज के डेट में इन्वेस्टर्स शेयर होल्डर्स एवरीथिंग आर वेरी लिटिगेशन इंथुजियास्ट। अभी सब कोई ये रहता है, सब कोई के मन में एक अपने जुडिशियल के ऊपर विश्वास भी है कि चल कोर्ट में देख लेंगे, तो ये एक एटीट्यूड और आजकल लोगों का प्रति ये भी हो गया है, लीगल पर में भरोसा भी है कि बहुत सारे जगह आप देख रहे हो IBC भी इतना सारे चीज को आंसर्स दिया है और NCLT एंड ROC हैज रियली प्लेड दिस पर्टिकुलर कॉर्पोरेट फील्ड्स हैव प्लेड अ ग्रेट रोल। तो इसीलिए यदि आप एज अ गुड प्रैक्टिस यही है कि यू कैन एडवाइज योर क्लाइंट दैट वी कैन गो फॉर अ बाईपास रूट वेयर वी कैन रिक्वेस्ट द ROC फॉर द पर्पसेस ऑफ कैंसिलेशन ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर SRN एंड वेयर वी कैन गिव अ फाइल अ फ्रेश SRN। और फिर मैं आपको 131 बता रहा था रिगार्डिंग द वॉलंटरी रिवीजन ऑफ द फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट, बट दैट विल अगेन डिपेंड अपॉन द फैक्ट ऑफ द केस, वहां पे जो वॉलंटरी रिवीजन है वो दैट इज विद रिस्पेक्ट टू फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट एंड बोर्ड रिपोर्ट, सो दैट इज अगेन अ सेपरेट सेट ऑफ डिस्कशन।
वन थिंग मिस्टर स्पीकर,
यस,
आई जस्ट हैव वन ऑफ द वे आउट ऑफ दिस सिचुएशन। It is being dealt in the rule 10 of Companies Registration Fee Office and Fees Rules 2014. According to this rule, if the ROC come into the information of any such types of mistakes or incompleteness, then this is the duty of ROC to give the procedure being heard to the applicant within 30 days of such information or the knowledge suo moto. Then instead of going to section 131 or any other rules, we can also proceed, put our situation before the ROC with an affidavit that this was not our intention, but a bona fide mistakes and bona fide situation created, which why we overlooked. On that basis also, we can impress upon the ROC to give the opportunity to cancel the earlier erstwhile STP form SRN. And give it the opportunity to file once again.
And the new form.
What is your view?
Yes, sir. So that is from the side of the ROC. वो वहाँ पे ROC suo moto कर रहा है। वो आप अब ROC को जाके खुद advice अपने मतलब practically how practical it is that we cannot go and ask ROC to give us a notice and we'll reply and give an opportunity of being heard. But जैसा मैं बताया कि यदि अपने को from the better perspective or better compliance, बहुत सारी company होती है जो लेट कम एनी थिंग इन द वे ऑफ ए कंप्लायंस, सो दे वॉन्ट एवरी थिंग टू बी अ टोटली कंप्लायंट, इवन इफ उसमें लाख दो लाख खर्चा लगे या कुछ भी चीज हो, सो उन लोग चाहती है भले ही वो छोटी कंपनी हो, प्राइवेट लिमिटेड कंपनी हो, XYZ। तो इसीलिए उस केस में आपके पास खुद भी ऑप्शन है कि आप वो जो है आप सुओ मोटो आरओसी को जाके इन्फॉर्म कर सकते हो एंड दे हैव अ पावर फ्रॉम द बैक एंड दैट सब्जेक्ट टू, और अभी वहां पे एक लेट डाउन रूल्स भी आ गए हैं कि वो जीएनएल में फॉर्म फाइल करके विद द पेमेंट ऑफ स्पेसिफिक फीस द एसआरएन विल बी कैंसिल्ड एंड अ फ्रेश फॉर्म विल बी अपलोडेड इंस्टेड ऑफ दैट.
To sum up this, we means we have the three ways. One is 131 suo moto, second is the backing, and third rule 10, which
from the ROC, which will be exercised by the ROC.
We can exercise by us with the help of the ROC.
ROC.
This is the situation to help this because a lot of audience present here must be facing such type of problem day in day out. So these three options is available with the help of Rahul Pranamsumaraji, their expertise. Sir, we have some questions in the chat box.
Yes.
With your permission, I would like to read out.
Yes, definitely. Definitely.
Mr. Sasang Khetri is asking, if an inquiry was called by ROC and after attending the personal hearing by the company, is there any time limit for the ROC to send a report to the central government and how to obtain the same copy of order?
See, जो इंक्वायरी जैसे मैं आपको बताया कि यहाँ पे कहीं पे भी एज सच जो है टाइम लिमिट का अपना कोई स्पेसिफिकेशन नहीं दिया हुआ है कि ये जो चीज है बिकॉज ये इनका अंदर का डिपार्टमेंटल वर्क है तो एज सच यहाँ पे इनको ये कोई टाइम लिमिट नहीं है. लेकिन कभी भी यदि जो इंक्वायरी है यदि से सपोज यदि सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट मिनिस्ट्री ऑर्डर किया आरओसी को कि आप एक्स वाई जेड लिमिटेड कंपनी का इंक्वायरी कीजिए तो वहां पे वो टाइम ऑलरेडी स्टिपुलेट कर देते हैं पहले से. बिकॉज आप देखोगे आप आरओसी जाओगे तो आपको लगेगा वो आपको टाइम नहीं देंगे, बोलेंगे अभी मैं मिनिस्ट्री का रिपोर्ट बना रहा हूँ अभी टाइम नहीं. आप यदि बहुत जन जाते होंगे तो उनके पास आप जाइएगा तो अभी मिनिस्ट्री और भी हाइपर एक्टिव है तो आपको हर ऑफिसर के डेस्क में एक मिनिस्ट्री का रिपोर्ट और वो मिलेगा जहाँ पे दे आर बिजी इन आंसरिंग द रिपोर्ट एंड क्वेरीज ऑफ द मिनिस्ट्री. सो दैट नोटिस और ऑर्डर ऑफ द मिनिस्ट्री इटसेल्फ स्पीक्स अबाउट द टाइम विद इन विच द रिपोर्ट हैज टू बी गिवन. बिकॉज क्या हो सकता है कि यदि मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ कॉर्पोरेट अफेयर्स को से सपोज कोई दूसरा मिनिस्ट्री ने लिखा हो कि ये इन्फॉर्मेशन चाहिए सो दैट इज वाई फॉर द पर्पजेज ऑफ दैट टाइम बाउंड नेचर वो रिपोर्ट और ऑर्डर इटसेल्फ स्पीक्स अबाउट द टाइम विद इन विच द आरओसी हैज टू गिव अ नोटिस. And regarding the obtaining the copy of the same order, you can file an RTI because as such you are not permissible to get the copy. And say suppose if your matter has been launched into a prosecution or SFIO, to वहाँ पे क्या है? You will be served with a copy of the order because 100% the principle of natural justice has to be adhered to, and you have to be the ROC or any of the investigating officer has to give you a opportunity of being heard. Uske bigar to they cannot proceed further. Otherwise, they will lose their case in future because that is the first and foremost principle of any law where other side must be given an opportunity of being heard. Yes. So we can.
Sasang ji saying thank you, sir. Any other question from the viewers? They may please raise their hands so that we can put a question here. One Mr. Mohit Sartani, he is asking, ki, "Bhaiya, please share your PPT if possible." Okay, we will talk to the speakers. And there is no such questions for this, sir. No such for the questions.
Yes, perfectly. So if anybody wants to unmute themselves and ask the question, so we can do it that way itself.
Friends, it seems there is no such questions, and of course Rahul ji has really dealt with very nicely and very deliberately, and his experience was very evident here while he was giving the deliberations and all the questions he has raised, and particularly the last question which was raised with respect to the skip route to how to correct our incompleteness or incomplete documents, he dealt with very well. And thank you, Rahul ji, for giving your valuable time to all of us and make us more enlightened on the subject of inquiry, inspection, investigations. Of course, sir, whenever we have the further opportunity to call you, of course, we will love to call you once again. By that time, Please stay safe, stay healthy in your home. And all the audience, thank you very much, without whom the program could not have been successful. Thanks a lot once again to all of you. Pranam.
Thank you, President, sir.